Climate change is not a joke. Some people may doubt it's a thing, but more and more people are beginning to see what the melting sea ice will do to our planet, with many taking the time to change their habits and speak out in protest, like with the Global Climate Strike, a school strike organized by and for young students who have grown frustrated with their government's lack of action. However, perhaps the biggest influence of climate change won't be on the planet. I mean, the planet will still be a blue ball floating through space. Nothing we can currently do will change that. Nor will it necessarily kill off all life. We're really just causing a huge mass extinction. Granted, that is still horrible, though. But perhaps the greatest threat, or at least the greatest change, will be to ourselves, us humans, and our society. By now, I'm pretty sure you've heard it all what will happen if we let the climate's average temperature raise by as little as 2 degrees Celsius. That's average temperature, by the way, which is different from the temperature merely going up by 2 degrees. It's actually more like if Berlin became comparable to Budapest, or if New York became like Baltimore. Just thought I'd make that clear. Now, even though that's actually a lower estimate of what's likely to happen, basically what will happen is we'll let all the polar ice caps melt, and we'll lose places from New York to Bangladesh to Denmark to Florida. I don't want to live in a future without Florida, man. And the ecosystems will be thrown out of whack, some places will get too dry, some too wet, some too hot, and we're all gonna die. And that's going to cost us something like $1 trillion. Although there are currently low-lying places like Kiribati, Tuvalu, New Orleans, and the Maldives, which are already starting to sink due to climate change, one of the places perhaps being most transformed is a place I can't even show properly on my stock world map. The Arctic. You see, the Arctic generally spends its time covered in ice. So the ice up there suddenly going away is also already having huge geopolitical impacts on the surrounding area. 7 countries border the Arctic Ocean: the US, Canada, Denmark via Greenland, Iceland, Norway, and Russia. And all these countries want a slice of the Arctic pie. One of the main points of interest within the Arctic is its untapped natural resources. According to a 2008 assessment by the US Geological Survey, there are about 90 billion barrels of oil, 47 trillion cubic meters of natural gas, and 44 billion barrels of natural gas liquids up in the Arctic. And many multinational energy companies are already fighting for permits to extract from these areas. However, this is where the borders come in. And no, I'm not going to be talking about visa policies in this video, as the Arctic Ocean is, well, an ocean.
Wow, good observation, genius.
This means that the Arctic Ocean is governed by UN maritime law, which states that nations have an exclusive economic zone going out to a certain distance from their shores, usually 200 nautical miles or 370 kilometers, from which they are allowed to do things like extract resources even outside their territorial waters. Drawing out the normal lines, we would get borders that look something like this. Very neat and tidy lines indeed. But there's still a lot of Arctic Ocean left unaccounted for, and the UN also allows countries to extend their EEZs to 650 kilometers or 350 nautical miles offshore, provided that the continental shelf extends far enough for them to do so. For those of you who don't know, a continental shelf is essentially an extension to its respective landmass that just so happens to be underwater at this point of geological history. As such, the water in these areas is much shallower than the rest of the ocean, meaning the continental shelf, which is also made of continental, not oceanic crust, is essentially a part of the continent that just so happens to be underwater, much like the underwater bit of mighty Zealandia or the protrusion that once formed the US state of Florida. Sorry, just thought I'd future-proof my video, just in case. All 7 Arctic Ocean-touching nations have submitted their surveys of their continental shelves, and thus their territorial claims, to the UN. But wouldn't you know it, they all overlap with each other. What a big surprise! Russia in particular, however, has shown a vested interest in gaining influence in the Arctic, and has been said to not exactly view climate change the same way as much of the rest of the world would view it. After all, a warmer climate would likely result in Russia's permafrost wasteland turning into vast swaths of arable land. And also, they could probably get seaports that didn't freeze half of the year. In the Arctic Ocean itself, though, Russia is also building up its presence, militarily, economically, and politically. This is both in the obvious ways, as in putting more troops up there and placing a Russian flag on the part of the seafloor that touches the North Pole, kind of, but also with presences in places like Barentsburg, a Russian mining settlement on the Norwegian island of Svalbard. It's really no secret that Barentsburg is vastly unprofitable for Russia, But in this case, it's not the money that Russia's after, but its strategic location for the potential new resources in the area, as any country who signed the 1920 Svalbard Treaty is allowed to do this as long as there's no military stuff going on up there. However, it's not just oil and natural gas that will make the Arctic more important on the world stage in the coming decades. It's also shipping. Now, we all know that long-haul flights like New York to Hong Kong or London to Los Angeles will go directly over the North Pole, as that's the actual shortest distance between these cities. But ships obviously haven't been getting this chance. At least, not until recently. For ships, this is a shortcut known as the Northwest Passage, which will likely cut the journeys of cargo ships by thousands of kilometers compared to many routes that go through the Panama Canal, especially going from Eastern Asia to Western Europe or the US East Coast. This means that a ship can cross the oceans with less fuel, which means more cargo and, interestingly enough, fewer emissions. However, even this could be a potential geopolitical advantage to countries like Canada. If you want to learn more about this, be sure to watch this Wendover Productions video for more info on this specific topic. I'd just be repeating it if I dove further into it here. But despite all the extra natural resources and potentially reduced shipping costs, there are still huge prices to pay. All this isn't necessarily a positive, just the most not horrible aspects of climate change. Sea levels will still rise and inundate major population centers, weather patterns all across the board will become much more severe, and on top of that, these natural resources are not going to last forever. It's been predicted time and time again for the last 100 years one will run out of oil, with many estimates that turn out to be completely wrong, but no matter what the precise date is, there's only so much the Earth has for us to go around. If the idea of saving the natural environment isn't enough for us to switch to renewable resources, perhaps we should at least keep in mind some of the perils that climate change will have for our civilization, even with its perceived upsides. Either way though, thank you as always for watching. Please be sure to like, share, and maybe consider supporting the channel on Patreon. Also, maybe consider following me on Instagram. I actually have two pages there for the channel, where you can get frequent updates, video topic polls, and travel posts. And of course, be sure to subscribe to learn something new every Sunday.